Okay, yeah, I'm actually the command historian for RD&E Com. But because there's no other history offices in the APG South, I end up kind of functioning as the historian for APG South and somewhat for the North too. Next slide, please. What we're going to be talking about, of course, is the Lower Peninsula, or Gunpowder Neck, as it was originally called, later known as Edgewood Arsenal, Edgewood Area, and APG South, as it is today. There's another whole talk on APG North if you ever need that, too. Next slide. Let's start off with World War I, because Gunpowder Neck was a very scenic place. If you can imagine this whole peninsula heavily wooded, maybe some wheat fields. It was used for hunting, resorts, the whole recreation, and nothing really commercial. And then along comes World War I. Next slide. And there's two things that really impact Gunpowder Neck. The first one is when the Germans initiate large-scale chemical warfare against the Allied troops. This is all, of course, before we've entered World War I. And the initial use, of course, is about 150 tons of chlorine. And it had a significant impact, although it didn't change the course of the war or even the course of the battle they used it in around Ypres. But the headline down there is what really impacted the United States, since we were neutral, and the fact that they had initiated the large-scale chemical warfare, we saw that. Next slide. The thing we missed, though, was also the beginning initiation of biological warfare during World War I. The Germans used covert operations here in the United States, primarily to hit the horses and mules that we were sending out to the Allies before we entered the war, and they were looking at using glanders and anthrax. However, glanders was common in the horses whenever you got a herd together. So it's hard to say what the impact was, but we didn't really know about the first biological attacks until after the end of the war, during the war claims, did we really find out some of these activities. Next slide. So initially, when we entered the war in April of 1917, we had 2 years, you would think, to prepare for the United States to be ready to fight in a chemical war. But we really did nothing. We had no organization, we had no equipment, we had no protective masks, anything of our own. And at the beginning, when we entered the war, we had a loose organization. The Bureau of Mines, Department of Interior, a civilian organization, because of their expertise on expertise on toxic gases in mine shafts, they took over the war gas investigations and eventually moved to American University. And I'm sure you all heard about American University, but that's the first organization. The Ordnance Department was charged with producing the chemical weapons, producing the gas masks, the signal alarms, and the engineers with the training of the troops and also the special gas troops that would be using the main chemical weapons at the time, which was the Stokes mortar, 4-inch Stokes mortar, and the 8-inch Livens projector. This organization, or disorganization, resulted in our first infantry division landing in France without a gas mask, which doesn't make sense when you're going into a known ongoing chemical war. The Ordnance Department began looking for a place to build a chemical production facility, and they finally selected Gunpowder Neck, primarily because it was owned by one family, just about the whole thing, Cadwallader family. And it was no major city around it. You can see up in the upper left picture, that's the little town of Edgewood with what's now today the Amtrak line running through it right there. It had some access to shipping through the Bush River, although both the Bush and the Gunpowder are very shallow rivers, so they had to do some dredging. And it had access to the railroad track for shipment out. President Woodrow Wilson, in late October 1917, authorized the construction of the first large-scale chemical production facility here at Edgewood. And we had guards at the front gate shortly thereafter. If you notice, they are armed with rifles, with bayonets. The rifles are loaded. In at least one incident where a person got shot and killed by going through the entrance. There was a little bit more to it. They finally thought it was the guard's fault, but it just shows the seriousness of what we were doing here at Edgewood. Next slide. Eventually, what started off as Gunpowder Neck Reservation became known as Edgewood Arsenal, after the name of the little town just over the railroad tracks. Colonel William Walker was the first post commander, and he began construction of a large complex of chemical agent production and chemical agent filling plants. You can see the peak strength here, 7,400 military, 8,500 civilians. Initially, they were going to have civilians run the plants, but they decided after an incident in the summer of 1918 where the civilian population working on the plants panicked and rushed to the main front gate thinking there was a gas leak, and Colonel Walker had to come and tell them, no, we're not even producing gas yet. So they decided to use the military to run the plants here. Next one. By the summer of 1918, you began to see the formation of this very good chemical warfare service, eventually becomes the Chemical Corps. Under Major General Seibert, the initial research work at American University becomes the research division, medical divisions there also. We become the gas offense production division, Edgewood Arsenal. The gas mass production or gas defense production is up at Long Island, so we don't have that mission. Proving ground is at Lakehurst, New Jersey. As you probably heard, some of the items recovered up at Lakehurst. That's why they're doing that there. The training camp was next to it. And then they have two development and administration. And then the European division was with the American Expeditionary Forces, which include the 1st Gas Regiment. Next slide. This is the aerial view of what eventually was constructed at Edgewood Arsenal, during World War I. You can see there's three shell filling plants, one shell dump, and then four production plants. The chlorine plant was across Canal Creek over on this side, so it's not really on this photograph.
Which is north on this picture?
North is roughly at an angle to the left here.
Okay.
So if you're familiar with Hoadley Road, Hoadley Road runs roughly right through here. This is kind of Hoadley Road right here. The chapel would be over here, and we'd be kind of up in this area.
See how many of the buildings are recognized. Go ahead.
Well, the only one, the three shell dumps are still there today. And so is the central power plant, which you can see in just a moment. And some of the phosgene mixer buildings are still there. But everything else is pretty much gone. Okay. This shows the shell filling plant number one. That central power plant is still there today, next to the newest building on post, which is the new heat to steam building, I think it's called. What they were filling is this, the 75 millimeter shell, about the size of a Coke bottle. And the challenge was to how do you fill these? Because the French were filling 75s, but they were literally filling them and then using them on the Western Front within a matter of very short time. We realized that we would have to ship it out to the on boats. And so we can't be leaking or anything going across the ocean because that would create problems. So we used a civil engineer by the name of Edmund Chance, who copied the American bottling industry, like if you're a beer bottle or something, liquefy the chemical agent and then fill it and cap it. And once it was filled, take it across the little road there to the shell dumps where they were painted and prepared for shipment out. The first shell filling plant primarily focused on the filling NC, chloropicrin stannic chloride mixture. Of course, chloropicrin is one of your vomiting agents. You get a whiff of that and you throw up in your protective mask or someplace else, but in theory, you want to get the soldier to throw up in his protective mask, so then you not only harm the soldier, but you also harm the equipment to go with the soldier. Stannic chloride was kind of a tear gas, basically, tear gas smoke. We also filled some of the Livens projectors there with phosgene, which was pretty much the most lethal chemical agent at the time during World War I. Shelfling plant number two was focused on the mustard agent. That was came out in about 1917 when the Germans introduced that agent. It was very good because it's the persistent one, like motor oil, splatters on your skin, causes blisters, and will also is very persistent. So of course it'll stay in the shell holes and everything for a long time. We filled about 155,000 75 millimeter shells in this plant. The interesting thing to look at is that most of the soldiers have very little protective equipment on, and that's the actual filling line when they're doing the actual operations.
What could go wrong?
Production of the agents was also relatively complicated. The first production plant, which looks like a backcountry still or something, was two reactor units brought up from American University where they were being tested in the pilot plant. And this little structure here produced the first 50 tons of mustard agent here at Edgewood. And you can see what some of the recovered World War I mustard agent looks like today. The permanent mustard plant, it looks like this up in the top picture there. That was operational starting in the summer of 1918. There was the first procedure was on the left here. That was the French. We copied the French design, which used a higher temperature and a lot of sulfur in it and caused the lines to clog continuously. The soldiers would have to clean out the lines. There would be casualties. One soldier was killed due to exposure to a mustard agent and then probably going to the hospital and being exposed to influenza at the same time, which those two don't go together very good. But it was, sometimes we had over 600 incidents of casualties resulting from that process. In the late summer, in the bottom right picture, we got the British system of Levenstein mustard agent, which was much easier to produce. And that plant was far better than the French version. Next slide. We also had to have a depot to store the chemical munitions in. If you recognize these buildings, they're right over here. The kind of the middle one right there is where the 22nd Chemical Battalion used to be, and now CARE is in there. But that's where we stored them. And we tried to have a chemical laboratory here, but because American University was the main research site, they said, no, you can't have one. So Colonel Walker was able to get around that by saying, what we really need is a laboratory to verify the quality of the agent we're producing. And so that's where Edgewood got their first chemical laboratory. This building doesn't stand it anymore. We also had to have troop barracks. We built 16 troop barracks. Of those, 13 still stand. They're down there by the chapel. Where some of the JPEO elements are in there now. They're going to tear them all down except for one pretty soon. So we're only going to have one of these historic buildings left. Now the war came to an end November of 1918 relatively fast. Edgewood Arsenal was just beginning to get up to full production. And literally on November 11th, they dropped their tools and they had an assembly. The site of this assembly is right over here where the new MRICD building is. That's where they assembled for this ceremony. And because the Edgewood Arsenal was part of what's called the National Army, which was kind of a temporary force during World War I, it was not like the regular army, there was a big question about whether Edgewood Arsenal would be able to continue, or where they were going to shut it down and turn it over to industry or something for a chemical plant. Now, I have to tell you about the mustard agent shells that were filled here at Edgewood. There was about 155,000. We didn't get them over to France until right at the end of the war. And the war ended, and so they said, okay, we're going to ship them back to you. So they came back across the ocean. And we said, well, you know, what are we going to do with them? So we loaded them on a ship, the USS Eleanor, in Baltimore Harbor, took them off the coast of Delaware and New Jersey on that map there, and we threw them overboard. Literally, hand by hand, threw them overboard. This is what they the left 75 is what they look like. Now, if you jump ahead to 2004, everyone wants clamshell driveways, where they take up clamshells, grind them up, and put them in people's driveways. Well, stuff started appearing in people's driveways, and the clamshell companies started finding 75 millimeter shells with good mustard agent in them in their grinding machines. So we had to respond to that, and we've recovered quite a few of those now. And it's kind of interesting that Edgewood elements have had to go up and respond to those incidents to retrieve the shells that we filled here during World War I. But that was a very important find that we were able to show, that find the log of the Eleanor and trace the route and everything to show why these mustard shells were. You can see the one on the right there is how good they come out of the ocean after 75 to almost 100 years later. Okay, between the wars, next one. Edgewood Arsenal, luckily, here's the good news that they will continue as a permanent installation called Edgewood Arsenal. So they take over the old hospital administration building and convert it into our headquarters building. You can see again, during World War I, we only had two missions, agent production and munitions filling. After the war, we have all these other missions that come. We get the research mission, we get the gas mask production, the medical research, the training, the testing, and the depot. All that comes here to Edgewood. We don't get the headquarters of the Chemical Warfare Service. That stays down in Washington. But we're pretty much it on everything else. This is some of the projects we worked on in the 1920s. We built another chemical lab, number two. We continue to focus on mustard agent, very important, and particularly trying to find a full protective outfit. And that's actually a gas chamber right there that they could test out some of their protective equipment. However, during the 20s, of course, there was a lot of cutbacks, and we kept growing smaller and smaller in size. So we began to pick up some outside civilian projects to work on, like particularly the pesticide program, how to eliminate boll weevils in the cotton crop, how to protect pier pilings from sea creatures, that kind of thing. We also had the school mission come here, the chemical school moved down here. We built two buildings near the headquarters building, which you can see kind of in the upper left right here. This is the old post headquarters building right here. This is what's called the Edgewood Gate. This is the golf course right here. So on the golf course is where they did their training, including how to decontaminate mustard agent on the ground. Downrange, though, they did the Stokes and the Livens firing. The gas mask facility took over one of the rings of the old World War I chlorine plant across Canal Creek over near the Magnolia Gate. And we hired an enormous number of women from the local counties to come here and sew gas masks, because that's the way they were produced in those days. And so that's where all these women are. And you talk to many people in Harford County, they'll tell you, oh yeah, my mom worked in the gas mask factory. Of course, there's all these other interesting stories about one of the ladies wrote a note to Mrs. Roosevelt saying that the lady across from me has sharpened her fingernails and is poking holes in the gas mask. I think she's a German agent. And so the FBI came down and investigated and said, no, they're just women fighting, I guess you could say. But next slide. We also got the medical research mission, which is some of the more interesting work in toxicology, and also checking that the equipment worked. And what the guy is doing in that bottom right picture is that tank he's looking at is filled with a chemical agent. A line comes from that tank to a gas mask filter, and then from the filter to his face piece. And what he does is he breathes through that canister until he can smell the gas, and then he raises his hand or something, and they're timing it. So that way they say, okay, that canister is good for 3 minutes in that particular chemical agent.
I want that job.
And the interesting part of that is often you use officers, because the officers would volunteer first to do a lot of these chemical agents. Next. One of the interesting things about chlorine, in addition to the Germans first using it, and in addition to what we know is being done over in Syria with chlorine weapons, we actually considered chlorine a medical treatment. And Edgewood created a mobile chlorine chamber and a on-site Edgewood Arsenal chlorine chamber to treat all these different things. So you'd get a whiff of the chlorine and I guess it would burn out everything in your lungs that was there. And they treated senators, they treated the president. I'm not sure which president, because it was right in between two presidents and both of them had health issues, but you can see that it was very practical. It seems to have only lasted during the 1920s before they figured out that they were, you know, burning people's lungs. Still, with all the cutbacks and everything, Edgewood was beginning to look pretty small population for such a big gunpowder neck. So they divided the posts into two separate installations. And the field artillery, the 6th field artillery particularly, came in and created what's called Fort Hoyle. And that's why you'll see Fort Hoyle Road off the post here. And our gymnasium is called Fort Hoyle Gymnasium. That's because the Hoyle Gymnasium that we know today was their riding hall. That's where they trained, the officers trained with their horses indoors. The headquarters is right across from the rec center down here. If you look at the old World War I troop barracks, one of them has these fake arches on the front of it, right across from the rec center. That was the old Fort Hoyle headquarters building. You can see it down there on the right. And they happened to fire 75 millimeters, so they were firing these. And it was thought to be a nice relationship. You know, they could test fire the mustard agent rounds. But they had to share buildings with the chemical guys, and that didn't work out at all. There was always fights, and, you know, the chemical guys would make some joke about smelling like horses, and the horse guys would say, you know, you smell like gas, and, you know, there would be a fight. So it didn't work out. The Chemical Warfare Service immediately started asking to kick out the field artillery shortly after they were here.
So there's still the same houses down there by the...
Yes, that is why there is two separate housing areas, because in 1923 when they started building the houses, they built a batch down there for Fort Hoyle and a batch up here for Edgewood Arsenal. So that's why you have two separate things in there. One of the big accomplishments, I mentioned the 4-inch Stokes mortar. It only had a range of about 1,100 yards, so we took that and we rifled it in one of our little machine shops that no longer stands there and created the famous 4.2-inch chemical mortar. That was one of our big accomplishments. Doubled the range to 2,400 yards at that time. Eventually, we were up to over 5,000 by World War II. We also focus on ROTC training, reserve officer training. Their camp used to be where Kappa Field is today. That's where all their... This is the parade field down in Edgewood. You can see the officers' housing right there, back in the back there. If you look carefully, they've been placed and are loading Stokes mortars and Livens projectors, which they could fire from that position. We also did research on a new type of device that was not used during World War I. That was the spray tank. You can see the 1926 airplane hangar there that's still there today. It's, of course, been fixed up a little bit. But we developed a lot of the early spray tanks, and they used to practice spraying them right over the airfield. They didn't use chemical agents, as far as I can tell. They mainly used smoke and the simulant for mustard, which was molasses residuum. Again, one of the most important things was how to protect against mustard agent. You can see on the left here, we developed a cape that you could put over you. And what the guy is doing, he's probably an officer because they always went first, is he wears that, he goes downrange and he holds a little card in front of him, and then they come over and spray him with mustard agent and they count the number of hits on that card to tell what the dispersion rate is. So that's what he's doing there, is standing there waiting to get sprayed with mustard agent. We also worked on horse gas masks. We put in a diaphragm in the face piece so you could communicate. The other ones, particularly the first World War I gas mask, had a scuba top mouthpiece where you couldn't communicate and had a nose clip so you couldn't breathe. Not very good for communications. And the top right picture is we began to experiment with using smoke in amphibious landings. But by the end of the 1930s, our World War I plants are in disarray, they're falling apart. Chemical agent production is very corrosive, very hard on buildings. And right at that point, When our facilities here is already falling apart, there's stuff going around the world, particularly the Italian-Ethiopian War. In 1935, the Italians invaded Ethiopia, or Abyssinia as it was called at the time, ran into some difficulties. Mussolini authorized the use of chemical warfare against the unprotected Ethiopians. You can see that they used mustard agent, chlorine, tear gas, and toxic smoke agents. Yeah, we had observers with both units, both sides, and Captain Meade, who was with the Ethiopian army, as he says, mustard gas is still the king of the battlefield, particularly because you could spray a dusty road. The Ethiopians who were barefoot would come through, raise up a nice cloud, and it'd make a mess. The other one we kind of knew about was the Japanese-Chinese War, where Japan invaded Manchuria and was fighting with China. They resorted to chemical weapons in 1937, including mustard agent, hydrogen cyanide. That's one of their glass grenades down there. We kind of copied that, used a Coke bottle for it. Lewisite, which is similar to mustard agent, phosgene, tear gas, and toxic smokes. Then by 1939, they started working with the biological agents, including anthrax, cholera, typhoid, plague, and hemorrhagic fever. So everything is began to look like it's okay to use chemical weapons and biological weapons on the battlefield. The thing we didn't know about was the Germans' work with the nerve agents. By 36, they had already identified GA, Tabun, and then by 38, Dr. Schrader had discovered GB. And by the beginning of the war in Europe in 1939, they're already producing nerve agents and have over 1,000 tons produced by 1940. And we missed this entirely. In fact, we have there's a great statement by one of the Chemical Warfare Service officers saying, no, there's not going to be any new agents because we know all of them. We're confident that we are ready for war. And you see some of the weaponization that they already had accomplished by the beginning of World War II. So along comes World War II. We say, okay, you know, they're using chemical weapons, they're using biological agents on different battlefields around the world. We gotta be ready. It's probably World War II is gonna start with massive waves of planes coming in, dropping chemical bombs on us and everything. Well, it didn't. And President Roosevelt decided to issue the policy that we will not initiate chemical warfare unless we're attacked first. And that became the policy of the United States. But we're going to be prepared. And so he builds an enormous complex here at Edgewood and replaces all the old World War I buildings just about. E-3330 down the road here becomes the main chemical headquarters for both laboratories and administration. One of the things we had to work on was how to protect not only the military soldier, but also the civilian population, particularly, for example, at Pearl Harbor. We rushed into production what was called the bunny mask, which was a pillowcase that they sewed two little ears on for babies, just so we have some sort of emergency one. But one of the issues with young children wearing masks is that they don't like them, and you can't get them to put them on. So we actually brought Walt Disney here to 3330, and he helped design what became known as the Mickey Mouse gas mask. We also had the other civilian masks up there on the right, and then we began to get into the collective protection, where we can run, like hospital patients can run off of one canister. Same with tank crews. We also worked with detection. Most of the detectors, we had no automatic detector. Instead, it was a matter of verifying whether the mustard agent were present on the ground. So they came up with the M9 detector unit showed there. The first mechanical smoke generator that was used at Anzio. And then our decon trucks, which were really good for showers, because we didn't need them for decon, really. So the troops used to love when a decon unit would come by because they get nice hot showers. Medical research became very important during World War II because we had to work on protective ointments. We had to make sure the equipment worked. The soldier had to have confidence in the protective equipment. If they didn't, then as they discovered after a D-Day, when the troops landed with their protective equipment, the whole road from the beaches to the fighting was strewn with gas masks and all the things that the soldiers decided was a waste of time. And so we actually had gassing chambers. Those buildings are still down there. They're right down just past the old MRICD building. You'll see them on the left there. They're in real bad condition and they're going to be torn down pretty soon. But we had several gas chambers in there. And what these soldiers on the left are doing is we were working on a protective underwear. So that underwear is treated. They send them in with, as you can see, with only the underwear on, and then expose them to mustard agent and then take pictures of them to show all the burns and everything that they had on them. We also expand the chemical school building, which is up when you're going out the old front gate. You'll see it about the last building on your left next to the golf course. We connected those two individual buildings. And again, we did a lot of work. Down the bottom left, one of the big things we produced here was the sniff sets, or case kits, the chemical agent identification sets, which were bottles and tubes of small amount of dilute chemical agent, including mustard agent. And what you would do is you'd, like these guys did, dig a little hole, it had a little burster on it, blow the burster, creates a little cloud of mustard agent, and then the officers are approaching it and taking off their masks and sniffing, doing the sniff test. And when you sniff it, you say, okay, that's what mustard agent smells like. So this was done on the golf course. So if you're using the golf course, watch your divots, of course, but that's where they did that. You can see the railroad tracks kind of behind them. We also took them, the soldiers downrange and then surprised attacked them with tear gas quite often. And again, up the upper right picture, we're doing decon training and using live chemical agents. We also had an arsenal operations facility here. This is building E5101, JPEO's building, headquarters building across the airfield there. That was built during the war. The plants themselves were under the arsenal. We took one of the wings of the old World War I mustard agent plant and we renovated, and that plant produced most of the mustard agent here at Edgewood during the war, but it couldn't keep up with the expected demand, so that's when we began building the other chemical weapons arsenals around the country, including Rocky Mountain Arsenal, Pine Bluff Arsenal, and Huntsville Arsenal, which is now, of course, part of Redstone Arsenal in Alabama. We built all new shell filling plants. This is long building here was the mustard filling plant. It is still there today. It is shipping and receiving behind the fire station. Next to it is the phosgene plant, which is still there, used by ECBC for mask training. We also had two other missions that were unique to Edgewood that did not have anything to do directly with chemical warfare, and one was the incendiary bomb program. The incendiary bomb building right there is still standing. It's down, when you go down Hoadley Road, just past E5101, and you see the operations center on the left, and then the next building down is that incendiary bomb building. It's now ECBC smoke operations or something building, but it still stands there. The interesting thing about it is that when Jimmy Doolittle was planning his Tokyo raid, he asked for some incendiary bombs, so they were assembled in that building and given to Jimmy Doolittle. The other interesting thing about the incendiary bomb program is that, as you probably know, incendiary bombs killed far more people than nuclear weapons did because of the firestorms that were created in many of the cities. Also, another kind of aside to that was probably about 20 years ago, we decided to name this building the Jimmy Doolittle Building because, you know, he was the most famous person involved in that building. And our deputy commander at the time said, no way am I naming a building the Doolittle Building. That's a true story. So we had to find someone else because he wouldn't let us name it the Doolittle Building. We also did flamethrowers. That was a big program. Flamethrowers were used some on little bit amounts during World War I, but they were not very successful. Or the range was way too short, and the operator got shot long before he could even get close. And in fact, the Germans began using their own prisoners to be flamethrower operators because they were expendable. But by World War II, the top flamethrower there, that's unthickened. By World War II, we had the thickened version, which is the bottom one there, that produced that fine line and significantly increased the range. We put them not only portables, but we also put them on mechanized on the vehicles. They were used very successfully in the Pacific theater against Japanese bunkers. We also completely rebuilt the whole troop barracks area. You can see on the left there are the 16 original troop barracks, and we covered this whole area down there with the stables for Fort Hurl is still there by around the Fort Hurl gym, but all these World War II barracks are still there. And you can see the World War II hospital complex that we built on the site of MRICD right here. That was there. We're up in this area somewhere. But all those World War II barracks are gone today. We have the World War I ones, and we have the 1960s and the 1980s, but no World War II barracks. The war came to end on Victory in Europe Day. It was May 8th, 1945, and as you all well know, the first nuclear weapons were used to help end and get Japan to surrender on August 14th, and starts off the nuclear age. We, however, had been producing all these chemical agents, and we did forward position a lot of them, and that caused problems during the war, like the famous Berry Harbor incident, where the Germans bombed our storage ship, and it spilled mustard agent all over the harbor, and a lot of people were injured and died from it. But we had a large stockpile, and so that's why we had two gas yards of storage here. A chemical agent storage yard will remain our main chemical on-site storage of 10 containers of mustard agent for many decades. Once we overran Germany, we discovered their nerve agent production capabilities. They had already found or discovered GA, GB, GD, GE, and GF. Of course, the story is they skipped GC because GC was the British abbreviation for gonorrhea. So that's why they decided not to use that one. By 46, we decided on GB instead of the GA. I'm not sure why, but apparently they selected that one. We began to produce it here at Edgewood in what used to be an old World War II plant. We called it the pilot plant, and it was known as the pilot plant for many, many years until the 1990s when there was a environmental disaster there, and three of our civilian leaders got indicted for felony environmental law breaking. But we produced the first large-scale nerve agents. The actual large plant was out at Rocky Mountain Arsenal. The British followed this up with a discovery of the V series, or venomous series, and we did the pilot plant work for that also here at Edgewood, and then they built the VX plant out at Newport, Indiana. So we had a significant role in the production and development of both the agent, the nerve agents, and the weapons to go with those nerve agents. Another mission that a lot of people don't know about is we received the nuclear defense mission, including some offensive capability, particularly not nuclear weapons, but radiological weapons. In other words, like dirty bombs. We had that mission here right after the end of World War II. Supposedly, the Chemical Warfare Service had been offered the nuclear mission before they used them on Japan, but we declined it as being outside of our area of expertise. So we did get NDL, as it was known. It was out by the Magnolia Gate. The main building on the bottom left there is gone today, but the hot cell or bunker where they stored the radioactive materials is still there by Magnolia Gate. If you ever go in that area, you can look over and see it. The whole plant closed down about 1970 and moved up, the mission moved up to Aberdeen, and today is part of ARL, Army Research Laboratories. Along comes the 1950s and 60s. It's a problem for the Chemical Warfare Service because they did not use chemical weapons during World War II, basically. So it gets harder and harder to justify the existence of a large chemical corps if you're not really, you're only in case of organization. We did get converted to the Chemical Corps in 1946. The Korean War comes along, and we primarily support them, or support the war, with the flame incendiary and the 4.2-inch chemical mortar, which in fact is the main ground weapon for the chemical units there. It's so popular, the ordnance actually takes it away from the Chemical Corps, and so we lose our ground chemical units, offensive chemical units. And the chemical school moves down to Fort McClellan, Alabama in 1951, so we lose the training mission. But we still have an important mission, the chemical defense. We have the newest protective mask, the M17, which eliminates the big canister on the side of your face piece and puts the filter material into the cheeks. And it has a Vorsmitter and a drinking capability, which is something new because with the nerve agents, now you have to wear a mask much longer, so you have to make sure the soldier remains hydrated. We had the first automatic detector system, the M8 alarm, which you could put out the detector out in front of you, have the alarm next to you, and any sort of cloud of agent coming in would set off the alarm and allow you to put on your protective mask. We had to have decontamination, the M11 sprayer there that would decon the nerve agent. And then the big thing was collective protection, particularly with some of our discoveries of what the Russians were doing after we captured Egyptian equipment, or the Israelis had captured equipment during the Arab-Israeli wars. We started putting collective protection on everything, vehicles, all the different trailers, everything needed collective protection. One of the things we did here, though, was the incapacitation program. In the 60s and 70s, we really wanted to have an agent that we could disseminate and not kill somebody, but make them so they render them inoperative. And so we began to look at a lot of the agents, including LSD, various marijuana derivatives. We brought in soldiers in a formal program called the Human Volunteer Program, starting in the 1950s. We would, there's a great video showing everything, how wonderful it is to come here to Edgewood, and they show pictures of women in bikinis over at Ocean City and say, you know, come on down here and enjoy your stay here. And then what they would do is inject them with LSD and the agent we finally decided on, which was a BZ, which was a powder, and then watch them go through the training and everything, and they stumble around and fall down, and they're really quite funny. But the problem with the incapacitant program was that you couldn't predict the response. One person, it might make react very quickly. The other person may have no impact whatsoever. So the Army eventually, although we did stockpile it, we did not use it on any battlefield. Now, of course, other government agencies who remain anonymous did use some of that technology and started covertly giving people LSD, and people began jumping out of windows and things like that. And that became associated with the Army program. And so most of that got all shut down by 1975. We stopped this human volunteer program. Now we still use, of course, human volunteers, but not for in this format. You know, it's more like fitting of the gas mask and things like that. We also had a large stockpile now. Most of the World War II chemical weapons that we had forward positioned, like the bombs, were thin cased and started leaking the minute we got them out to the tropics, so we just dumped them overboard, did sea dumpings. We did a lot of sea dumpings here from Edgewood. We still had other stuff. We bought some German bombs here right after the end of World War II, and we had to blow them down at J Field. That was where the technical escort unit really made its name after the end of World War II, is eliminating all the stockpile. O Field is notorious for how we did stuff. Right there, they dig a trench, they put like in it, everything from ton containers to all sorts of munitions, pile wood and stuff on top, and then light them up. We did open air burning. Eventually, the sea dumps are going to be banned. We can't do those anymore. And that's going to be the necessity about 1971 when we really decide that we have to have a professional chemical demil organization. So you see what becomes CMA today, starting when there were PM Chem Demil. So Edgewood had a big role in disposal of chemical weapons. Along comes the Vietnam War, and that primary what we're looking at is the use of tear gas. We develop a lightweight field mask, the M28, you can see there on the left, that still has some protection, but doesn't have all the weight of an M17, but still protects the soldier against tear gas. A lot of riot control work, including taking a flamethrower and converting it to a sprayer, like we did on the right there. Some of the CS work, a lot of it was done here, but my favorite one is the left one there, which is the brown bagger. They take those little brown lunch bags, fill it full of powdered CS, put them in a box, and then when they're over their target, they open up the box, and all these little brown bags of CS fall and hit the ground and break open and create a pretty good dispersal of your CS. The next one over there to the right is the backpack. That unit has grenades in it. You wear it out and place it, and then fire it off, and it shoots out all these CS grenades. Also, we improved the type of the shape of the grenade, because our original tear gas grenades were these like soup cans kind, and we turned them into a baseball, thinking that a soldier could throw a baseball further than the can of soup can. But still, there was accidents, particularly at our facility, test facility out at Dugway Proving Ground. We were working with spray tanks and nerve agent, and the post got a call that sheep were dying around in the hills around Dugway. There was caused a big investigation. The Army never admitted really that they were at fault, but they paid off the sheep owners. And then we had forward positioned chemical weapons secretly in Okinawa and in Germany. And in Okinawa, they were sandblasting some of them to repaint them, and there was a leak, and there was no fatal casualties, but there were casualties there too. And the newspapers shot off hold of that, so we had to admit that we had forward positioned chemical weapons. And all that led to President Nixon in 1969 ending the production of unitary chemical munitions. Of course, this is a unitary chemical munition where you produce the agent, you produce the shell, put the agent in the shell, and it's ready to fire. It did not ban the continuing research on binary chemical weapons, where you take that chemical agent, break it down into two less than lethal chemicals, and you don't load it into the projectile until you're ready to fire it. That was simple plan later on. But we also ended the biological weapons program, which had been run out of Fort Detrick, Maryland. We kept the chemical here, and they did the biological, but the lines were kind of fuzzy. For example, we did ricin work here and tested ricin on some of our ranges shortly after World War II, and we also did a lot of the research on toxins. So some of our laboratories that no longer stand had experienced some of the toxins. But that pretty much ended, it bans open air testing too. So that pretty much ends our primary focus of chemical warfare production here at Edgewood. Along comes the 1970s and 80s, partly because we're getting smaller in size. They combined Aberdeen Proving Ground and Edgewood Arsenal, the installations. So we become the Edgewood area of Aberdeen Proving Ground in 1971, but we're still Edgewood Arsenal of the command. And that's always real confusing because we were both the installation and the command, both had the same name of Edgewood Arsenal. The controlling of the chemical weapons and the biological warfare continues. We play a significant role in this, in that Fort Detrick ended its biological research and production program and its main production site at Pine Bluff Arsenal. And we pick up the defense program here, the biological defense. So now we're CB. And we had the R already, so now we're up to the CBR. That's all completed, and President Ford signs 1975, the Weapons Convention. The command of Edgewood Arsenal ends in 1977. You can see what used to be called a commodity center, where we did all these kind of things. And for example, here's the disposal and escort. That's tech escort. That was where they were. ECBC, Edgewood Chemical and Biological Center, got a lot of the research and went over and became Chemical Systems Laboratory, which eventually will become the modern day ECBC down there. So this was the last time when we had a nice centralized organization. Now we're, of course, all a bunch of tenant organizations with somewhat overlapping missions occasionally. The challenges during the 1970s and 80s, one thing was collective protection. That's when we got the first collective protection tent, but we also had to realize that a lot of the fighting may be taking place in cities, which may not need a tent like that. So that's when they started developing the room, what they call the big baggie, where you could take a room like this and turn it into a collective protection. The masks changed again. We went away from the cheek face pieces to the heavy canister, because you could switch the canister during a chemical attack as opposed to the other M17, you couldn't. The first really good point detection system was the CAM, chemical agent monitor, and new decontamination facilities. We had environmental issues come up. The 70s, particularly, if you can see some of these signs here, this is one of the ranges. 110 pounds mustard gas buried here in 1955. And so tech escort and guys are out there digging them up and taking care of that problem. The old buildings began to come down starting in the 1970s. The World War I and II mustard plant is gone. The chlorine plant is gone. And the chloropicrin plant is gone. Those are all parking areas or empty fields now. The Doolittle building is right there on the bottom right, if you know where this is. That road, if you go down this road just a little bit further, you'll get to the chapel right here. Next picture. 1990s to 2000s. Keep going. Primarily, it starts off with our support to Desert Shield, Desert Storm, which threatened to be our first large-scale chemical weapons and biological weapons attack against us. And we realized although we had a lot of training, we really weren't ready for a lot of stuff. So we had to kind of rush in to design a mobile NBC reconnaissance vehicle. On the left there, using the German Fuchs vehicle. On the bottom right, we had to drag out an old design for a biological agent detection system. And we still hadn't got the newest masks out to the troops. So many of the troops on the left are still using the M17 instead of the newer M40. And we used, of course, the CAM. We also, shortly after that, is the famous Tokyo incident, where GB is released in the subway system. And this is changes kind of the tone of everything. You know, before we were always thinking about chemical weapons and biological weapons on the battlefield. Now it becomes an act of terrorism in our cities. And that's why, as Senator Nunn says, you know, now it's just, we're just waiting for it to happen in our cities. And this is the start of homeland defense and all those type issues. President Clinton signs the Chemical Weapons Convention in 1997, which bans all development and production and stockpiling of chemical weapons. We continue our research, and this is where we start getting into decontamination equipment that doesn't require water, you know, for the desert. Our first mobile biological detection system, the BIDS. The first version of this was assembled right over here at the Berger Laboratory, right down the road from you. A good mobile multi-spector smoke system, a standoff detection system, the Rascal, the M21, which can actually look out and see a cloud, and a lot of specialized masks, like the Apache helicopter masks, the Special Forces masks, a lot of things that we're working on. And we got all new types of equipment, biotechnology, computer-aided design. We get a biosafety level 3 laboratory in the McNamara building right down here. And we support the ongoing war of terror. A lot of stuff that we did in Operation Enduring Freedom, including identifying things, and same with Operation Iraqi Freedom, trying to identify whether it's a chemical agent or not. Homeland Defense, we developed the trailer to put around the White House and the Pentagon that would sniff the air, but look like an ice cream truck or something that people wouldn't get nervous about. Our latest mask is on the right there, the M50, which goes back to the canisters on the face piece. But the thing it adds also is the ability to put another layer of canisters on top of those for ticks and TIMs, the toxic industrial chemicals, which is beginning to appear. And then you got the different types of detectors for battlefields. That's the, forgot the name of it, but go ahead. The portal something. And then of course along comes the anthrax attack. We luckily just have the biosafety level 3 level capability here. So we did a lot of the support of identifying different items that came through. And in the meantime, after 9/11, our chemical agent stockpile was sitting out there right, if you've ever been out to the Casey site, is right next to the water, and we were saying, well, they could fly in or come in off the water and steal a 10 container of mustard agent. So we did what was called Operation Speedy Neutralization, where we took the 10 containers, cut them in half, drained them, and then shipped, did most of the neutralization on site, but shipped the residue up to New Jersey, who had a processing plant there that could eventually get rid of the whole thing, and we got rid of our last 10 container in 2005. So we're no longer a stockpile site, but we do, of course, still have a chemical agent present in our research laboratories. And this is kind of the last slide. I end with the end of the BRAC program, which happens to have been 5 years ago from today. This is the ceremony that ended it. We brought in a lot of new organizations. JPEO came in, and you can see all the new construction on the post. MRICD, Public Health Command, is building their new facility there, and JPO has their lab at the end of the runway. And also, we are doing the 100th anniversary of the installation, going off the date of October 2017, but throughout 2017, we're gonna be celebrating that 100 years of APG contributing to national defense, and that includes Edgewood area also doing that. So that's where I'm going to stop right there. That's kind of a, believe it or not, that's the quick overview. If you ever want more detailed, I got a 6-hour version if you want to know everything. But do you have any questions or comments? Yes.
In an earlier session, we had talked about the history of the EOD, and there was I think it was mentioned that the first bomb disposal service was started here at Edgewood as well. Does that correlate to the tech escort units, or is that just something that came out of some of the munitions destruction on the south side of Camp Oil?
Well, it depends on how you define bomb disposal. During World War II, Aberdeen area had an ordnance bomb disposal school right there by the golf course and where the new commercial buildings are on the left when you go in the front gate there. And that's why they kept finding bombs and stuff in that area. Edgewood, the tech escort unit, traces its history back to Camp Seibert, Alabama, where it was set up to primarily transfer weapons only. And they came up here and did transfers throughout World War II. And then they had, I mentioned Oldfield. Well, Oldfield had so many chemical weapons laying around it, including white phosphorus, that it self-detonated and blew mustard agent up into all the trees and everything. So Colonel White, who was the commander of the tech escort unit at the time, said, let me take over responsibility for all demolition and disposal operations here at Edgewood. And that kind of merges into the transportation. So they become the chemical EOD units. But if you think of it in that sense, then yes, they are the first chemical EOD units. But they did start at Camp Seibert, which is why we're still cleaning up Camp Seibert too, because that was a chemical school training site during World War II. All the places the chemical guys were are contaminated, unfortunately. But we also have the problem that all the schools and training camps around the whole country use those ID sets too, which are all dumped and buried at those sites too. So we still have our challenges when it comes to that. Any other questions?
So how this was the APG South region. How does that compare to the APG North? Do they have the history of the chemical up there? What's the, I know they had the ordnance corps there for a while. What's the big difference between North and South in the history of the region?
Primarily chemical. It's debated about whether chemicals were ever used up in APG North. We've found some references indicating they may have been, particularly during World War I in the 1920s. They did a lot of the firing for us of projectiles, but generally the projectiles were empty or had a simulant or something in them. So up there, however, during the 1950s, they got into the atomic weapons, like the Davy Crockett and the heavy atomic mortar. They didn't use the atomic weapons, but they used some of the sighting devices which had radioactive materials in them. So their concern is more of conventional weapons up in the Aberdeen area, and we're more concerned about chemical weapons. I say, yeah, conventional. We're concerned about chemicals. That's why the entire Gunpowder Neck is a Superfund site. And you can find chemical weapons anywhere, including right next to the troop barracks.
We know.
I have one more question. I did the Memorial Day ceremony narration two years ago, and talks about the first two casualties are buried there in the cemetery. But and I think that was the hospital complex there, where the what was Public Health Command headquarters.
Yes.
Right by the golf course. So is there a statistic on how many casualties were actually? I don't know the right term is. How many casualties occurred? Just due to all the different testing that's gone on and production facilities?
Not total. During World War I, though, only three people died from chemical agent exposure. Only one of them was mustard agent, where a guy working in the mustard plant went to his desk wearing his contaminated clothing, sat down, got up and left, and some soldier without protective equipment sat in that same chair, got the mustard burns, and then went over to the hospital and either got pneumonia or something from or influenza and died. The other two were phosgene fire. Back in those days, they had a small fire department, but it was the responsibility of soldiers in adjacent buildings to go fight the fire. And so two soldiers ran out there to fight the fire wearing the gas mask. Fire department arrived, turned the hoses on, knocked off their gas masks, and they got lethal exposure to phosgene. So that was only three. Now there was 900 incidents of chemical agent casualties, but that was incidents and not individuals. So some of those guys got it like, you know, every week. Most of those were mustard agent, but there was other ones. There was chlorpicrin and all the agents. After that time, almost on a regular basis, there were fatalities, most of them not due to exposure of chemical agents, but due to explosions of various types of production equipment and fires. Almost all the later chemical agent exposures were non-lethal. We had some big ones where they would, around the mustard plant, people would be working, they'd start smelling mustard agent. And what happened is during World War II, they would do a run of mustard agent production and it wasn't very good. So they'd take it out into the swamp there behind the post theater and between there and the main part where we are, and just dump it into the swamp. And it, on a hot day, you'd get mustard fumes coming off the swamp and blowing into these buildings. So they took a couple decon trucks out there and sprayed bleach all over the swamp. But yeah, we have a list. I've never counted the total number. And for example, we were making igniters for firebombs at the end of World War II. And the production plant, which was one of those World War I shell dumps, exploded and blew out the whole center and killed 12 female workers and injured 67 other people. But it was not related to chemical agents.
Okay.